You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support the show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Wednesday, May 29th, 2019. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, Bottle of Lies, the inside story of the generic drug boom, with investigative reporter, Fortune contributor Katherine Eban. Also on the program, big press conference today by Robert Mueller. Mueller says Mueller time is over. But is it? Also on the program today, shocker. Mitch McConnell is all like Merrick Garland. What? Who? We can sit a judge in 2020. Joe Biden announces an education plan. Sanders offers workers dividends and board membership. Meanwhile, Republicans stall disaster aid in the House again. Iran says some in the U.S. want war. And John Bolton simultaneously pretends he didn't sabotage the Iranian nuke deal. Meanwhile, Dems look at their 25-24 candidate field and tighten the requirements for later debates. Bibi Netanyahu faces a deadline in just hours from now to form a new government. Let's hope he fails. Ben Shapiro defends himself as a convicted Nazi sympathizer, says that the non-Orthodox Jew disdainer, that would be Shapiro, led him to the alt-right and to commit acts of anti-Semitism.
You don't say.
More and more people are talking about Harriet Tubman. And the Department of Energy says it's freedom gas to you. All this and more on today's program. Folks, we are so jam-packed today. At 11 a.m., Robert Mueller made an announcement. We have some clips from that. Tomorrow on the program, Marcy Wheeler will be joining us. Very well timed once again. And we have a lot to get through today, not the least of which Mitch McConnell, of course, saying 2020, we can sit a judge or justice then. So anticipate perhaps that is an indication that maybe that Clarence Thomas is deciding to retire, or just that McConnell is, you know, getting his ducks lined up in the event that there is a one of the justices on the nominal left end up retiring or passing or whatever. I mean, this should not be a surprise. I mean, anybody who's even remotely surprised about this should have their head checked. And we should also say that, and we're going to do a deep dive into the what appears to be disturbing, sort of sad, bit of a breakdown that Dave Rubin's having. It's not funny.
It's a wonderful day here in Los Angeles.
He had a very tough day yesterday, and you know, we'll get into this more, but I just want to make this clear. I will laugh at Dave Rubin.
Me too.
But I'll laugh at myself too. Mm. Which is not to say that I think that I'm Dave Rubin. But that could blow your mind if you think about that. My point is, like I'm not going to pretend like I don't have a laugh at other people's expense, just like people have a laugh at my expense as a comedian. You have tough skin, thick skin, and but when we go through this stuff, I want to make it clear that, like, I actually do think that it's the least that I can do. Right? Like, I mean, I think, like, part of what we do here, I think we have a multi-pronged mission that has developed over the years. One is to bring you, works that have been done by people who write about policy or who investigate issues like what's going on with our generic drugs we have today. One of them is to push, frankly, an ideology, maybe sort of like a broad spectrum of left ideologies on this program. And the other, which I think is probably the, I don't know if it's dramatically different from the mission I may have had during the radio days.
To make Dave Rubin feel seen.
Well, but it's not specifically Dave Rubin, but it's basically to sort of say, what is the most toxic information, valves of information that people are getting that I, me, with my little butterfly wings, have any ability to in any way curtail? And that is an extremely limited, mission. My ambitions are not huge. Dave Rubin is not baby Hitler, you know, and we're not like, we don't have an opportunity to suffocate baby Hitler here. That's not what I'm saying. But I do think there are people, you know, and we've documented it in the past, who head down a very toxic pathway that is basically highlighted, door open by Dave Rubin. And others, and we go after them as well. That's why we do this.
Who's laughing now, Sam?
Well, there's others too, but we'll get to that. But the important stuff is Mueller right now, and we have footage of Justin Amash apparently doubling down in front of cheering crowds of his own constituents, calling for impeachment. Robert Mueller today, I think, got up there and basically said in a very much more reserved way, hey, what more do you want out of me? I just gave you your impeachment indictments, charges. But let's go through these a couple of these clips. We also have a clip, I think, that shows fairly conclusively that Bill Barr is just a liar. I mean, let's start with Robert Mueller saying that they did not make a determination that Donald Trump did not commit a crime. If they had, they would have said so.
We had confidence that the president clearly did not commit a crime, we would have said so. We did not, however, make a determination as to whether the president did commit a crime. The introduction to the volume 2 of our report explains that decision. It explains that under long-standing department policy, a president cannot be charged with a federal crime while he is in office. That is unconstitutional. Even if the charge is kept under seal and hidden from public view, that too is prohibited. The special counsel's office is part of the Department of Justice, and by regulation, it was bound by that department policy.
Pause it. Okay. So, all right, take that away. So there you have it. This is not an exoneration for Donald Trump. I mean, he specifically came out and said that. We did not, if we had made a determination, if it was really clear that the president had not committed a crime, we would have said so. They did not determine that he made a crime, but what does he say immediately after that? The Department of Justice says we can't make that determination. It is impossible for us to make that determination. When the investigation starts, when there is no evidence investigated whatsoever, there is nothing that we can find that can allow us to charge the president with the commission of a crime. And he just said, or he will in a clip in a moment, he will say, we would never say that he committed a crime because there is no judicial means in which for him to defend himself. So we're not in a position to do that. By we, he means the Department of Justice. Now, here is Bill Barr lying about this a couple of weeks ago. Now, he does it very, very carefully. The words but for is something that you learn in law school. And it means that but for the existence of something, something else would have happened. That's what a but for is. But it's an all or nothing thing. And so Bill Barr thinks he's being pretty clever here. But listen to the language he uses versus the language that Mueller is using. Bill Barr basically creates a straw man but for.
On March 5th, we specifically asked him about the OLC opinion and whether or not he was taking the position that he would have found a crime but for the existence of the OLC opinion. And he made it very clear several times that that was not his position. He was not saying that but for the OLC opinion, he would have found a crime. He made it clear that he had not made the determination that there was a crime.
Okay. So he made it clear that there was, now that is true. He did not play that last, just last line again. The number of double negatives that these guys are using is very, very, I think, specific. Go ahead.
And he made it very clear several times that that was not his position. He was not saying that but for the OLC opinion, he would have found a crime. He made it clear that he had not made the determination that there was a crime.
Okay, so yes, he had made the determination that there was play it one more time. It really is tough to get your arms around this. But basically what Barr is saying is that the last sentence he says is true, but that's not necessarily a function of the sentence that precedes it.
He was not saying that but for the OLC opinion, he would have found a crime. He made it clear that he had not made the determination that there was a crime.
Yeah, because he couldn't ever make that determination.
Exactly. And he wasn't saying that but for the OLC opinion, he would have found a crime, because that's not the order in which this goes. He wasn't looking for a crime because he could not look for a crime.
Not the game he was playing.
Not the game he was playing. And here he is, Mueller, making that point very clear today. Mueller has a written statement. He says he doesn't want to testify in front of Congress because his report speaks for itself. Reports don't speak, incidentally. You have to read them. But that aside, the words he speaks today, you know, were very specifically to address what Barr has said about him in the past. Listen carefully what he says here about why there was no charges brought. This follows exactly after he says we did not determine that the president did not commit a crime. And we did not determine that he did commit a crime. And if we had the former, we would have said so. We did not determine that he did a crime. And then he says, why? And the why is because that's not possible. We are not in a position to determine that he committed a crime. We're not allowed to do that. We don't have that ability. We don't have that ability any more than Sam Cedar has that ability. Sam Cedar does not have the right, the means, the capacity, the standing to determine that a crime was committed. Neither does Robert Mueller. This is all him saying to Congress, this is your job. Here's the evidence. But I can't do it any more than Sam Cedar could.
Second, the opinion says that the Constitution requires a process other than the criminal justice system to formally accuse a sitting president of wrongdoing.
To accuse. He cannot accuse. Period. End of story. He can't even set out to accuse the president. Period. End of story. He is on a fact-finding mission and is supposed to give that information to Congress. Continue.
Sitting president of wrongdoing. And beyond department policy, we were guided by principles of fairness. It would be unfair to potentially accuse somebody of a crime when there can be no court resolution of the actual charge. So that was Justice Department policy. Those were the principles under which we operated. And from them, we concluded that we would not reach a determination one way or the other about whether the president committed a crime.
Pause it. How can anybody say that that's not a but-for? From those principles, that we cannot charge a sitting president with a crime, that there's a constitutional process and not a judiciary process for charging him with a crime, and basic fairness says that we could not accuse him of a crime. That's a but-for.
Well, that's his job, right? He's the liar general.
Bill Barr. And so this is Mueller got up there today and basically said as about as explicitly as you could. Donald Trump could have shot somebody. We could have had videotape of it. And we could not accuse him of a crime.
That is
the bottom line. And he is saying to Congress, we found the videotape. We got the testimony from the people in the room. It's your job to accuse him of a crime. And that's what we witnessed this today.
Can I ask a potentially dumb question? How did the OLC come to the opinion that you can't indict the president? Because that just seems super wrong to me.
Well, that is, legal scholars would say that opinion is wrong. Or some would. And we need to go to the Supreme Court and have this argument. Supreme Court may or may not take it up. The Office of Legal Counsel is basically the Department of Justice's opinion wing. And they basically say, that's our opinion. And we're going to operate under those auspices unless a court tells us otherwise. Very unlikely that a court would say otherwise because they don't want to get involved in that. And they say, look, there's a constitutional remedy for this. It is called impeachment. And that's the way that it was set up. But yeah, there's a lot of people who think that opinion is wrong, but this is where law and sort of practicality smack up against each other. And this is what, when they say about there's a constitutional crisis, these are the type of things that they're talking about.
Well, right. If I was the court, I'd be like, that's just like your opinion, man, and go forward.
Yeah. I mean,
that's not how it works.
Well, we'll see. I mean, if we get the right president, maybe we can get you nominated.
Hell yeah. That would be quite the twist in my career.
Never saw that coming. All right, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, Bottle of Lies with Katherine Eban. We are back. Sam Cedar on the Majority Report on the phone. It is a pleasure to welcome to the program investigative journalist, Fortune magazine contributor, Andrew Carnegie Fellow, Katherine Eban, and her latest, Bottle of Lies, the inside story of the generic drug boom. Welcome to the program, Katherine.
Thanks so much, Sam, for having me.
I am fascinated by this stuff, and every year, twice a year actually, I go to a tort lawyer conference in Las Vegas, and oftentimes, many of the tort lawyers, I know it's a very strange thing to do, it's even stranger if you knew me, but it's fascinating to me, and many times I hear stories of that are very similar to the ones that you're talking about. Of course, yours are far more in depth and cover more of the broad. I've heard a story about Valsartan and a generic version of that, or the active ingredient, which had been produced in China and had been tainted. It's a heart drug that had been tainted with jet fuel. And
that's right, an ingredient that used to be used in liquid rocket fuel.
And, I that was a very narrow story. And then to see your book and to realize that is the tip of an iceberg, it is terrifying. But before we get to the problems with generic drugs, let's start with Cipla. Cipla, if I'm saying that right, this is the basically the beginning of generic drugs. Tell us the origins of generic drugs.
Yeah. So there was an Indian company called Cipla and a very heroic CEO named Yusuf Hamid, who got the idea that it is outrageous that all of these Africans should be dying of AIDS while the drugs necessary to cure them existed. But were tied up with brand name patents. And so he came out and announced to the world at around 2001 that he was going to make these drugs available for $1 a day. And the brand name companies tried to stop him because it was intellectual property. And the world basically came in behind Hamid and said, this is the right thing to do. Eventually, brand name companies caved. Hamid produced these drugs ultimately for 38 cents a day, joined by a number of other Indian companies. U.S. taxpayers began footing the bill to send those drugs to Africa. It's humanitarian and the right thing to do. But along the way, there was this question, how do we verify the quality of these drugs? So the FDA, which is our main regulators, came up with an abbreviated process for reviewing quality, deemed the drugs okay, and that gave everybody an idea. Well, wait a second. Our own regulators say these drugs are okay. Nobody at home can pay brand name drug prices. Why don't we take these drugs too? And that really was the beginning of the generic drug boom in this country. And one of the reasons why our drug supply is now 90% generic. And 40% of all those generics are manufactured in India. The majority of all our drugs are manufactured overseas in India and China.
Okay, so this is and it was that the Hatch Act, Waxman Act. Was that basically changed things, or when did that kick in?
Yeah, so that was a law that was passed in 1984, and what that did is it created a pathway at the FDA for generic drug makers to come in and prove that their drugs were bioequivalent, could be absorbed at the same into the bloodstream at the same rate, but they didn't have to prove safety and efficacy because the idea was, well, brand name companies have already proven that. But the Hatch-Waxman Act did something else very important. It created a huge financial incentive for generic drug makers. It was called first to file. And it said the first generic companies to file their application with the FDA and get approved will get 6 months of exclusivity on the market at about 80% of the brand name price. And that just set off this gold rush among generic drug makers to be first to market. So as I describe in my book, there were generic drug executives camped out overnight in the FDA parking lot, sleeping in stretch limos, waiting for the doors of the FDA to open the next morning so they could go and file their application.
What was the theory behind, and people should know, like, you know, that we're just sort of like setting the table here for how we got to where we are. And I want to circle back to the idea that, you know, some 80 to 90% of our drugs are actually made overseas, which is sort of stunning when you contemplate how much we hear about scaremongering about buying our drugs from Canada, let's say. But put that aside for a moment. What was the theory behind that first-to-file provision in the Hatch-Waxman Act?
So the theory was, if generic companies are going to have to brave almost certain litigation by brand-name companies, then they need a deal sweetener. They need an incentive, something that'll make it financially worth it. And this was the deal sweetener, that they could get this 6 months of exclusivity. And that just occasioned this rush to file applications, be first to market, and to get that 6 months exclusivity.
What is the nature of that litigation that was anticipated from brand name, that you guys are stepping on our patents?
Yeah, basically that, you know, brand name companies erect this barricade of patents around their drugs. They patent not just the molecule, they patent the process by which it's manufactured. They may patent the time release mechanism. And the whole idea is just to prevent anyone else from coming in and making their product. And so any generic drug company that wants to make a version of their drug is going to have to go to court. And it's going to cost a lot of money. So that was why they introduced a deal sweetener.
Okay. And I want to sort of like come back through all this, but let's also just go back a little bit so that we just get the idea of like where generics came from. My understanding, they basically started in India as basically a Gandhi's, you know, and under the sort of the rubric of Gandhi's nationalism.
Right. Well, there's the story I describe in the book that Gandhi went to Yusuf Hamid's father, who started Cipla, and said, look, it was World War II. The British have promised us our freedom. But in order to do that, they want us to help out with the war effort. And they need pharmaceuticals because the supply from Europe has collapsed. So if you can step up and manufacture drugs for the Indian Army, then this will be going a long way to helping to lead to a free India. And that's really how it started.
Okay, so we get the development of the generic drugs. It comes through in the 80s. The Hatch-Waxman Act basically provides almost a, not necessarily a safe harbor for first to file, but an incentive for people to withstand the onslaught of litigation they're going to have to wade through if they're the first to release this. Is it these patents that are built around, just if you could just, I guess, walk us through what's in a drug? I mean, I don't think people fully understand sort of like, how could there be subsidiary patents around it? How is a generic drug structured? Just, you know, sort of almost, I guess, dissect the generic drug for us so that we understand this.
Sure. So let's start with what a brand name drug is. It will have an active ingredient, which is sort of the principal molecule that does the healing. And in addition to that, it's going to have what are called excipients, which are additional ingredients. And then it may have some kind of time release mechanism, right? And all of that has been manufactured to be in a specific form, whether it's a tablet, a capsule, injectable. So, and it's all been engineered so it dissolves properly in the body. And then the way that's measured is the extent of the absorption into the bloodstream. So that's a drug. So the generic companies come along, and, you know, one common misunderstanding is people think, well, the brand company hands over the recipe to the generic. That almost never happens. Instead, generic companies have reverse engineering chemists who take a brand name drug, they break it down in the laboratory, they see how it's put together, and then they try to recreate it. They're going to use the same active ingredient. It has to be in the same format, tablet, capsule, but they're going to do a lot of things differently. There's going to be different manufacturing steps. There's going to be different additional ingredients. There's probably going to be a different time-release mechanism, and it's going to dissolve differently in the body. So it's not identical. It's a version of the brand name drug.
Is there a... Now, I understand, at least in principle, like, oh, well, we've already tested the active ingredient in this, and we've found through clinical trials that it's safe for human. Is there not any, I guess, analog to testing the new formulation? Like, A, how do we know that these chemists are good at their job? Like, they've reverse engineered it, and they've found, you know, the active ingredient that's on the label. But they don't know how it's been prepared. Like I know if you slice an onion one way, it has different implications of slicing it a different way in terms of the way that it cooks or something like that. Is there not something equivalent in that way? Like maybe if you prepare this active ingredient in this way, it actually mutates into some other active ingredient. Or if you combine it with this mechanism for blood absorption, it actually has this side effect as opposed to that side effect. I mean, do we have a testing process of like how this stuff is reconfigured that it might have other implications? Or am I just don't know anything about chemistry and don't understand? I mean, I think both are possible.
It's a great question you're asking because it takes us really to the center of the issue, which is the way that generic companies demonstrate that their drug is effective is through testing of the drug. So they're testing, they test on, say, 20 to 25 different patients, the absorption into the blood. But they also test in the laboratory. How does it dissolve? How quickly does it dissolve? Is it stable? There's something called stability testing, where they test, does it disintegrate? How quickly does it disintegrate? Under what conditions does it disintegrate? And all of that testing is accompanied by data that's really a kind of minute-to-minute laboratory blueprint of the way that that drug performs. And that data is really sacrosanct. It's at the center of the manufacturing process, and the companies have to submit that data to the FDA to get approval to manufacture a drug.
Okay, and so we are trusting that they're giving us the real data. Before we examine that, that dynamic, are there benchmarks set by the original drug? So you're saying, like, you know, it tests dissolution, it tests absorption, all this. Are there public, or at least does the FDA have benchmarks of the original drug? And to the extent that the FDA does. Does the generic maker know that, what those benchmarks are, or are they at least doing it blind and handing it to the FDA?
Right. Well, there are certain standards that are set out by different regulatory bodies. For example, like the United States Pharmacopeia is a standard-setting organization, and that standard-setting organization says, in order for this antibiotic to be viable, it has to contain this much active ingredient. So there are those kinds of benchmarks that are public, and they're based on the standards that are set by the brand name companies. But that's a little bit different than just handing over your entire cookbook, your recipe of how to make the drug.
Okay, so when this data comes in, and maybe before we even address, the fact that you have these drug companies saying, like, oh, here's our data, whether we have a way of validating that data. Why don't you address that before I ask the next question? Do we just simply trust these generic drug companies to say, like, oh, here's our data? We didn't look at the back of the book and see what the answers should be, in terms of absorption rates or whatnot. And here it is. Are we okay? Is that basically what happens?
You know, the answer to this question is a little bit shocking, which is that the FDA is essentially regulating these companies on an honor system. They are reviewing this data. Now, in addition to that, they are also they perform what's called a pre-approval inspection, which is they go to the manufacturing plant to see if the company can actually make the drug. Is it safely run? Is it in an outhouse? Is it in the middle of nowhere? So they do a pre-approval inspection, but this is a key distinction. A lot of these drugs are made overseas, and when the FDA does an overseas inspection, it notifies the companies weeks, sometimes months in advance, that its investigators will be coming.
And I think you have I don't know if it's a quote necessarily in the book, but it's you tell the story that one guy said, like, oh, we have access to cheap labor that we could actually create an entirely new facility with the amount of lead time they give us, and that one will be good.
That's right. I mean, they can make anything look like anything. So, you know, what they will do is bring in teams to, and maybe we want to lead into this because this is where
this is where things get a little bit dark, folks. But let's just start with this question before we get there. Why are, and I think you said 90% of our generics are made overseas between, India and China and maybe a couple other countries in terms of where particularly the active ingredient is made. Why is that?
It's sort of it's a long story with globalization at its core. Western companies realized that they could slash their labor costs, supply costs, if they move manufacturing overseas. There were much looser environmental regulations, and manufacturing of drugs throws off a huge amount of pollution. So there were all kinds of reasons why Western companies were looking to cut their costs, and there were all kinds of reasons why Indian and Chinese companies wanted to get into our market, which is the world's biggest and most lucrative.
Well,
so
how much
this
were
was
they
a win-win for all these companies?
How much were they also conscious of the fact that being not in close proximity to the FDA, like literally the FDA offices, is going to benefit us? I mean, back when I was in show business, we would say, like, oh, if we're going to shoot a show, let's shoot it as far away from the executives as possible. It's going to mean less scrutiny. And I mean, how much were they conscious
100%.
Of that?
Okay. They were absolutely conscious of that. So basically, you have all these companies who are 7,000 miles away from Maryland, where the FDA has its headquarters. And they are able to evade scrutiny with that distance, you know, and literally the closer you move towards FDA headquarters, the more scrutiny you are under.
Okay. And so let's get into a couple of the horror stories. But before we do, when people say, like, we can't buy drugs from Canada because they don't have the same, standards or mechanisms to determine, you know, that these drugs are pure or whatnot, that even that seems like a lie, because I got to imagine that the Canadian you tell me, maybe you don't know about Canada's procedures, but the idea that the FDA inspections happen with significant advance warning suggest to me that our system is pretty weak. Your whole book is about that, essentially. Does Canada have, like, do they have a similar procedure for, like, generic drugs?
Well, here's the problem with buying your drugs from Canada. If you buy your drugs from Canada, you're probably buying your drugs from India. They're getting Indian generics, too. And usually when you buy from sort of online Canadian pharmacies, there's little fine print in the disclosures which says, if we don't have this drug in stock, you authorize us to purchase it from our offshore partners. And let me tell you, when you're buying a drug, you don't want drugs from an offshore partner. So, you know, I am skeptical about this idea that in this, you know, snowy, clean place called Canada, you're getting quote-unquote Canadian drugs. But in a way, that's a kind of a different, somewhat different issue. But, you know, it speaks to the fact that there is a global drug supply, and India and China have become pharmacies to the world, and regulators, whether they're in Canada, Europe, the U.S., really don't have a firm handle on what is going on in those plants. And that's really the story I'm telling in my book.
Is there any, well, let's talk about the failure of our regiment, and then we can talk about whether it's any different than Canada's, for that matter. Or, I mean, I guess Canada's saying, well, you know, we buy it from India, that may not be subject to any, you know, the Canadian version of the FDA. But let's talk about, I guess, Sotret. Am I pronouncing that right?
Sotret.
And this is by Rand Baxi. Is that the company?
Yeah.
Yeah. This is, you know, sort of your premier nightmare story, I guess. Although we can also talk about, you know, you have a vignette of this guy, Peter Baker, who basically, you know, I don't know. That one's almost like low-hanging fruit. But talk to us about Sotret, because I think this is indicative of a major problem, obviously.
Sure. So there is a brand name drug called Accutane, and it's an anti-acne drug. But it's a pretty scary drug in that it came with what's called a black box warning. And the FDA warned people, you can't take it when you're pregnant. They warned manufacturers, we have to monitor how much you sell, where it comes from, all of that, because of the health hazards that are associated with it. It produced increased suicidality in teenagers. So it was a dangerous, scary drug. Rembaxi got approval from the FDA to make a generic version. Their version was called Sotret. Now, basically, Rembaxi was telling the FDA everything's fine. But they had a meeting, their executives, in a Boca Raton hotel in which they were confronting internal testing of the drug, which showed their version of the drug was failing. It was dissolving incorrectly. You know, this exposed patients to incredible hazards. Instead of disclosing it to the FDA and pulling the drugs from the market, which is what the company should have done, these executives in this hotel made a secret pact to keep the drug on the market, and even while they're selling it to patients, to go back into the laboratory and see if they can't fix the manufacturing problems. And the way they fixed it is pretty scary. And they didn't actually fix it ultimately, but what they did was scary, which is they swapped out ingredients. They took out certain ingredients and they put in different ingredients to try to make it dissolve correctly. The problem is you can't make an ingredient change without the FDA's approval. And the company did this all in secrecy. And they had an internal report in which they wrote up all of their findings about how the drug was failing with a big cover sheet on it that said, do not share with the FDA. And when the FDA raided their offices in New Jersey in 2007, they got a copy of that report.
And this was all started from a guy who had studied, I guess, in the States, right? This Thakur, is it? Dinesh Thakur?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
He came in, he provides a report for them, and their first reaction is, how can we destroy every copy of this report?
Right. So what happened with Thakur, he was a young engineer who was working at Bristol-Myers Squibb and got this job offer to go to India's biggest generic drug company. So he packs up his family, he leaves New Jersey, comes to this giant Indian company, and his boss, who has also come from Britain from a brand name company, begins to get suspicious about the data that the company is filing with regulators around the world. You know, and as we spoke about before, this is quality data that has a direct impact on whether the drugs are okay to take or not. So his boss gives him this assignment. I want you to go into every dossier for every drug we've filed around the world with regulators and investigate whether we have data that supports those drug applications. Thacker gets his team together. They do this investigation, and they discover this horrible secret, which is that over 200 drug products in over 40 countries have been filed with either data that didn't exist and was just fabricated, or that was changed, or in some cases the company was using brand name drugs and running data off of those drugs and presenting it as though it was tests for the generic. I mean, there were all kinds of substitutions. And this report that Thacker created got shown to a subcommittee of the board of directors, and their reaction was, how do we bury this, and let's destroy the laptop on which this report was created.
Wow. Now, this company has since been basically bought out. It doesn't exist anymore, at least in that form. What's your sense of how many of these stories are out there? I mean, you tell the story of Peter Baker. I think it opens up the book when he's investigating, you know, he's there inspecting a manufacturing plant. And literally, like, I mean, it almost seems comedic. There's a guy who just like looks like he's shady and runs away as the inspector's coming and tries to ditch a bag of reports that say, oh, there's all sorts of horrible, I think it was metal shards in this insulin production.
Yep.
How much of this do you think is actually going on? Like, is there any reason to believe? So, Rand Baxy gets fined $500 million, which is probably, you know, the equivalent of, you know, me leaving the lights on in the office over the weekends in terms of, like, you know, the cost of doing business for them. Maybe there is some civil litigation that they end up having to pay more, but they still, at the end of the day, it really is just not a question of anything other than what's our profit margin going to be on this? Is it going to be, 60% or, 35% or something? But what is this fixed? Like, do you take generic drugs? I mean, and really, is there any reason for us to be, comfortable with brand name drugs for that matter? Because they get their active ingredient from these same places, don't they?
So look, there's so much in what you just said. So let me just start with this, which is I did a big story in Fortune magazine in 2013 about Rambaxi, which ended up pleading guilty to 7 felonies. So my question, and really the beginning of this book project, was, was Rambaxi an outlier or the tip of the iceberg? And in my reporting, I began investigating the generic drug industry and essentially through whistleblowers penetrating these plants overseas. And what I realized is that the behavior of Rambaxi really reflected more of an industry norm. Now, Peter Baker is one of the characters that I follow. And as you say, the book opens with this low-speed chase through this hallway in a manufacturing plant in Aurangabad, India. But what he found, Baker, over 5 years, he inspected 86 plants in India and China. And he found outright fraud or some aspect of data deception, which was concealing or altering the quality of the drugs, or concealing or altering the environment in the plant, data that, reflecting the plant, in 4/5 of the companies he went into.
Wow.
This was 67 out of 86 plants he found fraud, which really, I think, tells you that this is endemic throughout the industry.
Wow. And so what about non-generic? Like, do we have the same problem because the active ingredients come from these plants?
Right. So here is the sort of fundamental issue to boil it down. As consumers, we are at the mercy of the companies that are making the finished doses. right? So there's companies that make the active ingredients, some of which are contaminated with materials used in liquid rocket fuel production. And you know, some of the companies are okay. But the ones that have the responsibility for testing those ingredients and formulating the finished product, we're at their mercy, essentially. We have to rely on the companies that we feel are the most responsible and ethical in testing, doing due diligence, and putting together those drugs. So, you know, at the end of the day, you want to make sure that that company is ethical, that company is transparent, that company is putting patient lives ahead of profit. You know, and if something goes horribly wrong, that you could sue that company. You know, and that's where this overseas production gets very tricky. I mean, the Justice Department could barely bring Rambaxi to heel for its conduct because it doesn't have jurisdiction, you know. And so we're in a pretty tenuous situation relying on these overseas companies to make life-saving medicine for us.
Yeah, I'm a little skeptical, Katherine, to be honest with you, about the when you talk about drug companies that are putting people's lives over profits. I have to concede that maybe I'm just a little bit cynical on that issue. All right, so let me ask you this. There's two questions. One, from a sort of like a just, I guess, a consumer a consumer advice. That is, there must be sites where I can go and I can see sort of like the records of these drug companies or where this stuff is manufactured that gives me the origins. And I'd like you, if you have information on that, to tell us. But the second would be from a legislative perspective, from a policy perspective, which I think is far more important ultimately because, you know, not that many people are going to hear this. And that's, you know, the way that if you really want to impact it, it's got to happen through legislation. What are the best ways to deal with this? Because I know, you know, the VA sometimes produces generic drugs when there's shortages, as it is now, a government entity. Elizabeth Warren has a plan to do that. Should we just basically say, you know what, we're not going to leave it to India and China, their safety regimes, to basically, you know, provide medication to us? The government should do it, or what? So, go ahead.
Yeah. So first of all, I agree with you. We shouldn't leave it to India or China to make our essential medicines. If India gets pissed off and says they don't want to give us antibiotics, we're really hosed. I mean, at the moment, we make almost none of our own antibiotics.
Right.
So that's fundamentally a national security risk. Secondly, consumers right now have almost no way to know where their drugs are manufactured. I mean, you actually have to be an investigative journalist to figure it out, unfortunately. So we need laws changed, and there have to be laws changed to disclose the location, the manufacturer of the active ingredient, and the manufacturer location of the finished drug. That needs to happen. There is no question. So where does that leave consumers right now? One thing they need to do is they need to know the name of the manufacturer making their drugs, especially if they're on maintenance medication. That name is on the label, okay? And here's why that's important. Because say you take a drug month after month, week after week, you have to know, is that drug working? Do you have weird side effects? Is that drug having the effect it's supposed to, right? If it does, you want to stay on it. But the problem is you go back to the pharmacy and they may switch you to a different generic manufacturer.
Right.
They're just filling it with what they have on the shelf behind them. So you need to actually make a request to stay on the same manufacturer's drug. So that's number one. Number two, how do you check out those manufacturers? Well, one way is a good old-fashioned Google search. Type in FDA warning letter and the name of the manufacturer, and then, in fact, you can see what has the FDA found in these manufacturing plants of that company.
If the FDA has found something, if the FDA has found a problem, you know there's a problem. right? I mean, because, right? I mean, like, this is, you know, some cop once told me, like, you know, for every ticket that we give you, there's some algorithm where we know you have committed, 100 different traffic violations. So if the FDA is finding them, if the FDA flags them for a problem, they must have some real problems.
That is correct, because you know that there are plenty of companies where that have problems and the FDA is not finding it.
Right.
So, you know, you want to be taking a drug made by a relatively clean company. And that's one way to try to start to figure it out. But, you know, I have to say, patients should also read my book because they will understand how this whole system is put together.
Okay. And so then from a legislative fix, a policy standpoint, we should probably be nationalizing at least the production of at least key drugs like antibiotics, it seems to me. But we should also, I mean, we need to do something on the policy front in a big way.
In a big way. And the other thing, frankly, that needs to be done, price regulation is part of this. I mean, one reason that we have been forced into the arms of these low-cost providers overseas is because nobody can afford to pay brand-name drug prices, right? I mean, so without meaningful price regulation, I think we will never get control of this. And the problem right now is that everybody is focused on the crisis of price, and it is a crisis. But what has been ignored in this is the crisis of quality, and there's a crisis there too. And you have to really consider these two things together.
Bottle of Lies, the inside story of the generic drug boom. Katherine Eban, thank you so much for your time today. Really appreciate it.
It was a pleasure to talk to you. Thanks so much, Sam.
All right, folks. We'll go to the fun half and talk about how our president is a criminal. How's that? Oh, cheer things up a little bit.
Fun, fun, fun. You know, I have on occasion bought modafinil from India online because I was prescribed it, but I couldn't afford to fill my prescription. And that interview makes me think it's the same stuff.
That you were buying? What do you mean? That,
like, there's not a huge difference between the drugs that you buy through legal means and the ones you buy online.
Well, I mean, I think she was saying, like, you know, part of it is that they're
like, they could all be bad.
They could all be bad. But I think it makes sense, particularly if you're taking, you know, drugs on a regular basis, to go and just see what that manufacturer is. I mean, it never even occurred to me that there could be variants as to, you know, oh, I'm getting the generic one. It turns out there's not a generic one. There's different generics, and yeah, great.
You want those generic-y generics.
Right, right. All right, folks. Gonna head into the fun half. Just a reminder, you can support this program by becoming a member at jointhemajorityreport.com. We don't need any type of agency to determine the quality of our shows every day. I can tell you 100% assuredness, the show is produced from the same manufacturing facility every single day. We are in close proximity to all of the podcast quality investigators. Whatever.
You can become clips from a place in India.
That's right. We do get the clips from a place in India. We do have to outsource that. You can become a member by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. When you do, not only are you supporting the free show that you enjoy every day, twice a week, three times a week, once a week, but you're also going to get extra content every day. So check it out. Jointhemajorityreport.com. Also, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. One of our oldest advertiser, really a movement partner in many respects. Just talking to Brendan today about the Cernovich episode a year or two ago. And if it wasn't for Just Coffee, I would have been fried. They were very big. The fact that they are just sort of, they are allies as Dave Rubin would never say. And also, great coffee. And you get 10% off with the coupon code MAJORITY, and you can get the Majority Report blend. Michael has taken a vow of silence for this week.
So I'd like to see that.
No TMBS. Well, you are, in a way. Haven't heard a word from him all day.
It's true.
So no TMBS, but you can go check out the YouTube channel. Catch up on all the TMBSs that you missed.
He's missing out on Dave. Imagine you were at a silent meditation retreat and you found out somehow that Dave Rubin was going through a pronounced breakdown.
I mean, honestly, that's the test.
On day two, you find that out.
It's like a 7-day fast, and all of a sudden, like on day two or three, they like bring in like, oh, who left these donuts here? And Jamie, you have not taken a vow of silence.
Mm-mm.
And so what has come of that?
So this week on the Antifada, we speak with Anna Merlin, author of Republic of Lies, American Conspiracy Theorists and Their Surprising Rise to Power. We talk all about conspiracy theories. What is it about the U.S. of A. that makes it such fertile ground for conspiratorial thinking, and why it's all capitalism's fault? And we will not be a less paranoid country until we are a fairer one. So check it out, folks. We also have for our patrons, History is a Weapon, number 4. With Sean and Matt Chrisman from Chapo Trap House, where they do their incredible galaxy brain grad school dropout thing and talk about the 1970s and how they prefigured a lot of what we're seeing today in this crazy world.
Matt, you also have not taken a vow of celibacy.
No.
Or silence.
Neither of those.
Neither of those things.
Yeah, literary hangover, the Margaret Fuller episode.
Do you think
is
there
now?
Is a vow of celibacy at the vow of silence? I mean, it's, who knows what
How can you get consent? You get nonverbal consent, I guess.
You're right, a
thumbs
no.
Up. Thumbs up.
Not, that's the way, there's all kinds of ways.
That's the way I do it.
That's a normal consent procedure anyway.
Thumbs up, thumbs down. That's a classic no.
All check right. Yes or no.
But yeah, check out Margaret Fuller, who gave thumbs up to her Emerson and Hawthorne, but neither of them was that into her. But she's a very interesting woman. She was early feminist and then sort of a socialist type of the Fourier, who was the utopian socialist before Marx. She was inspired by Fourier, who was like the socialism is he's why. Communists call themselves communists because they want to distinguish themselves from those utopian socialists. Mm. So she was into those guys, though. And they were actually a little bit more interesting than Marx makes them out to be. But check that out. Literary Hangover is going to hit its year birthday in 2 days. Five away from 200 on patreon.com/literaryhangover.
Oh, yeah. I need to listen to that. It sounds very relevant to my interests.
There is, I'm just going to say this once. I'm not, we're contemplating it. The upstairs offices are going over this proposal, but it was proposed that Suns Out, Guns Out as a mechanism which to drive membership for the show, where what would take place would apparently be that if we get a certain amount of members, I will wear a, a muscle shirt? Tank top.
Or a tank top?
Tank top in the fun half for an entire week.
The tape will show. I don't know if we can find it, but I was actually the first person to go Suns Out, Guns Out on this show. I actually went Suns Out, Guns Out. And you guys gave me crap for it, and I used that exact phrase, actually.
Did you? Yeah. I've never heard of that.
You know, I often have my guns out, but I think it's different for women.
Well, there you go. Suns out, guns out. We may do that. But in the meantime, see you in the fun half.
You are in for it.
All right, folks. 646-257-3920. See you in the fun half.
Are you ready?
Who sent us this?
Anarchy. Alpha males are back.